Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining how to configure Atom to create a layer 2 VPN to transport Ethernet frames over an MPLS infrastructure using Cisco iOS devices. I do my best to explain telecom and networking technology in a way that I wish I had been taught when I was learning. So if you find that approach useful, like, subscribe, and enable notifications. There's much more content to come, so this way you can stay tuned. MPLS is an extremely versatile data-carrying technology that is able to encapsulate a wide range of network protocols, including Layer 2 and Layer 3 protocols. In this video, we'll be creating a point-to-point Layer 2 VPN between these two customers using any transport over MPLS, or Atom, and we'll be encapsulating Ethernet frames. When you use Atom to encapsulate Ethernet, this is a special case of Atom specifically called Ethernet over MPLS, or EoMPLS. So let's get started. Now, much of the configuration of the underlay network remains the same as that used for Layer 3 VPNs. Since this has already been covered in previous videos, we'll just quickly review it here. We start off by configuring all of these interfaces with the appropriate IP addresses, including the physical and loopback interfaces. Then we configure OSPF on all P and PE routers so that all their networks are advertised to each other. All of the interface networks and loopback networks should be reachable from all P and PE routers. Now for Atom, we don't need to configure BGP like we did for VPN V4 configurations. We don't need VRFs either, and you'll see why shortly. Now we haven't yet configured our customer-facing interfaces here, but we'll do that now. To configure Atom to transport Ethernet Layer 2 frames, we do the following on the Gigabit Ethernet 01 interface, which is the customer-facing interface. We configure the interface using the xconnect command. This command creates what is known as a pseudo-wire on that interface. The word pseudo-wire comes from the Greek word pseudo, which means fake or imitation. The word wire signifies that we are creating a circuit or a direct connection at a low level. So a pseudo-wire can be thought of as an imitation of a wire or circuit that has been created between this and a remote endpoint. Pseudo-wires always function at Layer 2. xconnect and pseudo-wires are not specific to MPLS. If you explore the command more fully, you'll see that it supports encapsulation types other than MPLS as well. But I digress. As you can see, the command uses a destination IP address of 4.4.4.4, which is the loopback address of PE2. So we are creating, on this interface here, a Layer 2 pseudo-wire circuit that terminates on PE2. Next, you can see the number 20 here. Now, this is the virtual circuit ID, or the VCID. This number must be unique between the two PE endpoints being used. Now, the rest of the command simply tells the router what protocol will be used for encapsulation. And in our case, of course, the protocol we're going to use is MPLS. So that's all you have to do on the PE1 router. Let's take a look at the counterpart configuration on PE2. This time we apply it to interface Gigabit Ethernet 05, which is the customer-facing interface on PE2. Again, we use the xconnect command and use a destination IP of 1.1.1.1, which is that of PE1, and we use an encapsulation of MPLS. Once again, we use a VCID of 20 on this end as well, and this must be the same on both ends. Now, the result of all of this configuration is that these two interfaces are now, in essence, Layer 2 interfaces on the same VLAN. Now, we can test this by configuring the following. We can configure these two interfaces on our CE routers so that they are on the same subnet, 192.168.10.1 and .2. Now, these two routers should be able to ping each other directly, as if they were connected with a single Ethernet cable. Here you can see that if you ping the IP address on the other end, you get an answer. So we have successfully configured a Layer 2 VPN over MPLS using Atom to encapsulate Ethernet frames. Now, there are a couple of interesting things about this particular setup that I'd like to point out. First of all, we mentioned that we don't need to configure BGP or VRFs. BGP and VRFs are used to discover to which PE we should connect to get to our desired destination. However, our ADAM configuration uses a static XConnect command with a specific endpoint. Because ADAM configurations are statically assigned with a specific destination address, no mechanism is needed to discover the PE to which we want to get to. Another interesting thing to note also is how the underlying MPLS label swapping procedure takes place. Let's take a look at one of the LDP neighbors of PE1. Here you can see that PE1 becomes an LDP neighbor with PE2 directly. So far in our study of MPLS, we've seen only directly connected P and PE routers becoming LDP neighbors. This is the default behavior of LDP, which uses UDP and TCP on port 646 to discover and establish sessions with directly connected peers. However, in the case of EoMPLS pseudowires, the LDP session is actually established between the provider edge or the PE routers, and they do not have to be directly connected. When you configure a pseudowire between two PE routers, the routers will actually initiate what is known as a targeted LDP session to exchange the labels for the pseudowire. You can see that in this output here. The target in this case is the PE2 router, which is not directly connected to the PE1 router. Now, the PE routers still maintain their LDP peerings with their directly connected P routers. So what is the purpose of the LDP peering between the configured PE routers? That peering is used to exchange the VCID, which has been configured on each device. And that VCID actually acts as an inner MPLS label for the journey of this layer 2 VPN throughout the MPLS infrastructure. Take a look at a layer 2 transport binding for MPLS on PE1, like so. Here you can see the destination address of 4.4.4.4 and the configured VCID of 20. Now, what the two PE routers also exchange is the MPLS label that will be used to correspond to that VCID. Now, here we see that the PE1 has chosen the use of a label value of 19, and PE2 has also chosen a label value of 19. Now, what is the significance of this label that's exchanged between these two PE routers? This is known as the VC label because it corresponds to the VCID. But the most important thing here is that this becomes an inner label for MPLS. The VC label or inner label remains the same throughout the traversal of the encapsulated frame on the MPLS infrastructure. And it is that inner label that isolates this layer 2 VPN from all other layer 2 VPNs that may exist on this MPLS infrastructure. It's similar in function with the VPN label that is used with layer 3 VPNs over MPLS. So when the PE router sends out the encapsulated frame to the next P router, it'll add an outer label or a transport label to send to P1. This is our regular MPLS operation that we have come to know and love. So let's take a look at this traversal of the encapsulated Ethernet frame on this layer 2 VPN across the MPLS infrastructure. When PE1 receives the L2 frame, it encapsulates it in MPLS and pushes label 19, which is the VC label. That's the label that was communicated by PE2 that it uses for this particular pseudowire. PE1 also pushes a second label, the transport label, which corresponds to the label that the P1 router has shared with the PE router. Remember, the normal, directly connected LDP peers are still established here. So P1 receives this frame, swaps the transport label from 22 to 23, because P2 uses 23, and it sends it along its way. The inner VC label remains untouched. Indeed, it is not even read at all by the P routers, and this is another demonstration that shows that the MPLS core network cares nothing about what is carried by the data that it deals with. It only cares about those outer transport labels. P2 is the last P router in the path, so as always, penultimate hop popping takes place, and the data arrives at the PE2 router without the outer transport label. It only has the inner VC label. And based on that label, it knows to which pseudowire it should be sent. and it is sent out of the interface that corresponds to the VCID that in turn corresponds to label 19. It is decapsulated and sent as a layer 2 Ethernet frame and received by the customer equipment. So that gives you an idea of how layer 2 VPNs are configured using Atom and how they operate over an MPLS network. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to let me know in a comment below. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.